To link your social media summit powered by Pratham community, and we have some very interesting people today with us, and a very interesting topic also. We are going to talk about marketing strategies for Gen Z, and we have Gregg with us. Before I introduce Gregg, I have something which I want to show you guys so that we can wait for other people to join in. Let me share my screen and do the basics. Okay. Okay, we are right here. Okay, so welcome back, everyone. How are you? If you all can write, where are you all from? And then we will begin this session. Okay, welcome, Gregg. Welcome to the summit. A brief more about Gregg. Gregg is Chief Strategy Officer at Engage Youth Co. And he has done a lot of things. He is ex-skateboard player also. And he has told me something which is, I think, very important for you guys to listen. He will be sharing signed copy of his book with us to the five people who are going to ask questions to him. So that is going to be a very interesting thing. So do engage and do ask questions, guys. It is very important for you guys to ask questions, because why I am saying so is we won't get Gregg's time again. So his time is very valuable, and this is a time that you guys can ask questions and then engage with him, and it is going to be a fun thing which is going to be there. A bit more about Gregg. So he's a professional skateboard player, which all I said, and he has been working for the what are the things in the Gen Z domain for a long time now, and so the culture and everything is very different. And I will hand it over to Gregg to say more about what he has done, how he has done things, and those kind of things.
Hey, everyone. First of all, it's just like an honor to be here. I'm always excited to share parts of my journey. I'm a Pisces. I'll start with that. I am a former professional skateboarder. I've been, I started my first entrepreneurial venture when I was 16 years old. And it was, in fact, called Good Time Skateboards. And that was the beginning of my journey. And a decade later, after growing that brand into a global business, yeah, I got into the consulting and the agency side. And I have been helping brands build their audience to grow their audience and grow their business. For the past almost 30 years, kind of scary. And it's been a long, awesome journey. And I guess I'm in the right place, because I'm, when I looked at your materials, I'm also a keen learner. And I hope to learn from the other sessions that I watch as well, as much as I hope to share some knowledge with you. I guess I'll say, along this journey, especially on the agency side, I've had an opportunity to work with very innovative startup companies, yeah, all the way to, you know, Fortune 100 brands like Disney, Autodesk, Qualcomm, and many other tech, consumer product, consumer apparel, and consumer packaged good brands and retail brands. So it's been a very exciting journey, and I'm ready to go if you are.
Yes. So let me just turn on screen share for you. And then you can drop the knowledge bombs. Guys, if you haven't subscribed, please subscribe to the channel and like the video, because it is going to be an awesome, fun journey which we are on with Gregg. Gregg, your screen has been shared, and I think you can go.
All right, cool. So today I want to share four foundational strategies to reach and engage Gen Z audiences. I guess like that's a lot of you. And I'm hoping that a lot of these strategies are very global or very universal. They're not only strategies to reach Gen Z, like at this place in time. I believe that these strategies are foundational in the fact that they help reach youth culture. And so here we go. The first thing that I want to say is that, you know, Gen Z is not a demographic herd of sheep. And what I mean by saying a demographic herd of sheep, it's not just one monolithic, this is who Gen Z is, like some kind of stereotype. The demographic is specifically at this point in life stage, tweens meaning age sort of 9, 10 to 13, and then 14 to 18 being teens, and then young adults, which my understanding is a lot of you in that kind of 18, 19 to 24 demographic. And what that means is like Gen Z is a mindset. Gen Z is an attitude. Gen Z is also the young people that make up youth culture, which I think is the most important. You might actually see Gen Z looking something more like this, depending on the various interests or lifestyles. That Gen Z is an individual group, individual mindset, individual people that are a mix of many different interests, many different tastes, different age stages. And when you're seeking to get or connect with Gen Z, with you, and for those of you that are in businesses that are older, the key is to really understand how the different interests, how the different aspects of Gen Z work together. It's a complex and nuanced group to reach. So one of the key questions everyone has, especially from the brand or the organization, is how do you keep in tune with the tweens and the teens and the young adults of Gen Z? Well, first, you make Gen Z audience an extension of your brand or your company or your organization. And what that means is involving them, listening to them. One of the greatest strategies to involve them and listen to young people or listen to audiences, any audience, is to have an always on dialogue that's focused on tasks, feedback, ideation that can be brand, product, or content. And then inviting the audience to create, to give ideas and make reveal new ideas, and then find new ideas together. The types of participants in these advisory councils that we've found to be most effective are cultural insiders within the demographic or the target audience that you're trying to reach. That also a mix of representative consumers. That's important, not just influencers. The number of participants can vary based on your goal and what you're trying to achieve. 20 to 30 participants works. We've had up to 300 and numbers like 300, and then we've had 60, and we've had smaller numbers of like 10 or 15. And the idea is to have weekly tasks or communication, and then monthly larger projects or event type experiences to really keep the people that are advising you or ideating with you involved and keep them excited, making it fun. You can gamify the interactions by offering incentives and then you can interact. This type of interaction can happen on a variety of platforms, from Slack at its most basic to very robust research tools like Recollective and others. So here's an example of a Gen Z advisory crew council. We called it a crew that was designed for Walt Disney World. And really the goal was to understand what drives Gen Z visitation to the theme park and their requests for visitation to their parents, and then to co-create the plan with them together. So this I call it WDW, Walt Disney World Advisory Crew. The objectives are to understand the Gen Z mindset, to what were the resistance factors to versus going to like Universal or going to other parks or just other family vacations. Then what are the Gen Gen Z participants, the tween, teen, or young adults, aspirations, and then what are the visitation drivers? This particular project was focused on tweens, ages 9 to 13. So we looked at all the research that existed, did a lot of first and second tier research, created some hypothesis, and then recruited and engaged 60 hand-selected Gen Z tweens. And what we did is we worked over a six-month time frame to gather insights, ideate together, and used our proprietary Engage Lens platform with live streaming and mobile video. We gamified weekly interactions, and I'm going to go through it, show you some of the interactions. But what we did primarily was help name the YouTube and the Instagram channel. We came up with the strategy to reach them, understood the interrelations of the different social networks, the different social roles, like how would a tween work, how would an ambassador work, and then how would the fans interact, then really understood the vibe and the values and the creative look and feel, and then co-create content ideas and even hand-selected some of the influencers. Now, the key to all this working is that it's facilitated by experts who know how to bring, not just necessarily limited to young people, but bring people through this process, understand how to manage it, but also keep it fluid, you know, without any filter, so that it can feel real and be real. And then another key is that there's peer-to-peer conversation. So in this next slide, I'm going to show you one of the prompts, which is the request where we have young people that are participants in the advisory crew actually provide a peer-to-peer prompt or request for the members of the group to do their task. And there's a short video.
Hi, I'm Monica. Today I'm going to be sharing with you some forgotten Walt Disney World characters that they think kids our age would like. The idea is to introduce a bunch of characters that are found at Walt Disney World parks and, for the most part, have been overlooked. Today I'll be sharing two different character options Disney is considering as the leader of this group of forgotten characters. We would like to hear what you think of the idea, have you vote for your favorite leader, get your reactions to the main characters, and we have a fun activity planned at the end where you get to be creative and help come up with words the cast of characters might say or be thinking. These forgotten characters will have a funny unknown leader who will introduce another odd, lesser known character from all the different Walt Disney World parks to you every week for a year. Two of these unknown characters, Buff and Goat, are having a friendly competition to become the leader of these forgotten characters, and we need your help to pick a winner. But first, I'm going to tell you a little bit about each one, and then later on, we will have you vote for your pick to be the leader. Ready? Here we go! First, meet Buff. He's auditioning to be the leader of the forgotten characters. You've probably never heard of him, but he's mounted right here on the wall at the Country Bear Jamboree in the Magic Kingdom at Walt Disney World. As the leader, he'll introduce a new forgotten character every week. Here's how it might look when Buff introduces new characters. Now, meet Goat. He's auditioning to be the leader of the forgotten few. You've probably never heard of him, but he hangs out on top of Big Thunder Mountain in the Magic Kingdom. As the leader, he'll introduce a new forgotten character every week. Now that you've had a chance to learn a little bit more about Buff and Goat, we would like to ask you a few questions. If there aren't any right or wrong answers, we really just want to know what you think. So please share your honest opinions with us so we can help Walt Disney World create new and cool stuff for tweens like you. Ready? Here we go.
And then it moves into the platform and they do their next task. But you see, the key here is that it's not just adults speaking to younger people. We do a peer-to-peer type of prompting or engagement. And if we're doing that for future drinkers, obviously it doesn't have this kiddie or more youth, younger type of feel. It's really catered to the type of audience that you're co-creating with. This just happens to be a little bit of a younger audience. And then we collectively developed the strategy playbook, and we were able to integrate all of this knowledge of working directly with the audience into the entire plan with a dashboard for progress monitoring. And frankly, at the end, it just works to involve the target audience in a more intimate level in any kind of program. This is the results that we had on Instagram and YouTube over a 9-month time frame with very, very little paid media. So you can see being authentic and really connecting with your audience pays. So now that you have an advisory crew, or you're bringing the audience with you on the ride, one of the main, you know, questions that brands ask or that they struggle with is the actual brand or company itself positioned to reach Gen Z audience segments? Many brands, they jump to wanting to go right to social engagement, right to acquisition, right to selling product. But first, really, it pays. It's very effective, or it's very critical, I should say, to make sure that the brand is effectively positioned to reach the target audience. It doesn't matter if it's Gen Z or any real generation, but it's understanding who you're targeting. So the key strategy number two is to align your brand with the cultural lifestyles of Gen Z. And how we do that is by creating our brand platform. I call it defining or refining your brand platform. Defining if you don't have one, refining if you do have one and it needs to be cinched up, or it could be better honed in to have a more effective targeting. That brand platform encompasses your naming. It incorporates your brand, but certainly not just the values that you perceive your brand, but as the values from the mind of your target audience, in this case, Gen Z, and making sure that there's a shared brand value. Getting that story narrative right, modifying it if it needs to be, honing in your brand voice, getting your key messaging clear, if you have a style guide, determining whether it needs to be flexible, more flexible or not, to reach Gen Z, depending on where you're going to be communicating with them or interacting with them. And then that your overall design, brand design, look and feel, and your overall vibe is right. Because if you don't have your brand right, you're not prepared to communicate and interact with Gen Z or really any audience, it's likely that you're going to misfire. So it's so critical. Now, this is an example of a brand that's a global brand, but it's based in the United States. This is a skateboarding YouTuber that's now turned into the largest skateboarding media. It's called Braille. If you follow them on YouTube or on Instagram or TikTok, you know, it's very funny. It's very informative. They understand their audience, their name and their vibe and their style is very, very clearly connected with youth culture. They get Gen Z. They do a great job. They have, the largest subscribers of Gen Z of all skateboarding and related culture on the internet. And they get it. They get it so well that they're able to collaborate with Lego. They work with many different toy and different apparel brands. They've gotten so large that they've now launched footwear brands. So clearly Braille understands Gen Z. They know how to, you know, have their brand positioned effectively. But what about companies like, for instance, Thorn? Thorn is a B2B technology that helps defend young people from sexual predators. They're a B2B technology company. And when they wanted to create campaigns or programs to educate and inform Gen Z about the dangers or the implications of resharing nudes on the internet, they knew that this brand Thorn, this B2B brand, wouldn't be able to. It's too soft. It's meant for B2B. It's for adults. It's really to sell technology. They knew that this wasn't going to be the right way to connect with Gen Z directly. So they created a brand, a sub-brand, that they could position themselves effectively called No Filter, which basically shares real experiences with real people and real talks on TikTok and Instagram for young people to explore and understand different scenarios of resharing nudes and sort of what that means and what can be the implications or dangers of doing that without provoking fear. And so here you can see how sometimes if you want to reach Gen Z, it means refining or defining your existing brand, or other times it means creating a new sub-brand altogether that's going to be well-suited to reach Gen Z. Again, we have to have our brand foundation dialed in and ready before we're going to be able to do a great job of any other kind of communication or interaction. So now that we've brought our Gen Z audience along with us, together, we've figured out how to talk, how to get our brand, get our brand positioned to reach Gen Z. What are the right social platforms to reach Gen Z? It's one of the challenges that brands and organizations have. And we do that by looking at the data, and we look at the cultural intelligence. Because remember when I showed you that Gen Z isn't just this big blanket demographic, it's these age segments and these different cultural interest groups. So we want to be able to look at the data to know who and how frequent and how often they're using these social platforms in every country. The data is available to us. And then look to the cultural intelligence to understand to make the right decisions, because it may not be just the data that's going to drive you to which social platform to use. And then that'll inform your selection. And then we have the horse in the cart, because we want to select the social platforms that we're going to interact on. And yet we also want to establish our KPIs. So this framework, I'll talk you through this framework briefly. This is kind of an example, right? So here a program goal would be brand awareness. The primary social objective would be reach in this case. A social platform strategy would be TikTok, Snapchat, and Instagram, which I'll explain sort of why I put that in here with that horse in the cart effect in the next two slides. And a digital tactic here in this scenario would be organic content, influencer campaign, native paid media placements. And the measurement KPIs that we could extract from these platforms would be reach, impressions, geolocations, engagement volume, like how much engagement's happening, engagement rate, like how fast are we engaging, or is engagement or interactions happening on social platforms, sentiment analysis, do they like it? Are they loving this content? Regardless of how much reach we have or how much engagement we have, do they like it? You know, which is one of the most important metrics. And then the conversational volume, like how much of these conversations are actually happening, not just on these social platforms, that we, our own social platforms, but on all the other social platforms and individual accounts. So these are some of the KPIs. And this is just a framework, because you would start to fill this out yourself. Now, we have that horse in the cart effect. So to select the social channels, we can look at some of our data. This is some of our data working with kids, say, from Q4 2020. Let's say we're trying to target tweens. We're trying to target that 11 to 14 demographic. This data on the top, so the top line is the overall percentage of the 6,000 respondents. The green bar are females and the blue bar are males. So if we're targeting a equal balance male-female audience, if we just looked at the data, we would say, well, that and YouTube, and then maybe Instagram and TikTok would be our top channels, loosely speaking. So we could look at the data, and now I'm going to walk you through a scenario that would say, in this case scenario, we would use TikTok as the primary brand account, okay? And we would make the content for TikTok first. We call it a TikTok first channel and content approach. And then we would then use original audio. We would have quick cuts. We would use on-trend content and people. And then we would share, if TikTok was our primary channel, then we would share our content over and utilize that content for Instagram and for Snapchat. So in this case scenario, in Instagram, if that was our secondary account, we would have a brand account on TikTok, of course, a brand account on Instagram. And then we would, our organic content would come from the TikToks that we generate, plus a little bit of supplemental content. And then we would do paid media on Instagram. Then our tertiary or our third tier of priority, if it were Snapchat, there would be a non-active brand account. We would do paid media, and then we would use the TikTok assets for that paid media. Now, how you could bind and tie all of this together in a sort of a three-tier strategy would be that you would have strong, powerful influencers or content creators that had a presence that was relatively equal and strong on Snapchat, TikTok, and Instagram to weave it all together. Now, I just wanted to paint that picture to you on how maybe a three-tier social strategy could work. Clearly, you would go back to that, the KPIs, and you would look at your own data based on who you were trying to reach. But this brings a little bit of texture to it. So one of the challenges are, if, so let's say that we've now know we have a data-driven, a cultural intelligence-driven, and our, you know, our advisory group, we figured out the social channels that we want to be on, but we still might be unsure of the content themes and the formats that resonate with Gen Z or your target audience. So most importantly, we want to create content that contributes both to the culture of your audience that's important to them, that emotionally resonates with them, and to the platform culture. So it's very important to understand the platform culture. Obviously, platform culture on TikTok or on YouTube or on Twitch is much different than on Instagram or Facebook if you're targeting, you know, older demographics. So it's super important to weigh that in. And how we do that is by creating the right mix and the frequency. And it's so important to understand that that right mix and that type frequency has to be something that you can maintain. So in that other scenario, we didn't do original content on Snapchat because we just didn't have wouldn't have had the budget or the investment to create content that was purely just for Snapchat. So you think of what you can afford, what you can do, and then who your goals are. And so I'll talk you through this super briefly. It's just to think in terms of your content types and your content sources. Curated content, which is sharing and honoring and sourcing content from third parties. And your spin on it, your commentary on that. Your brand produced content in-house or by your agency. By yourself, if you're just an individual and you're starting a new business. Creator influencer produced by your creative partners and talent as ambassadors. And then brand collaborations, you know, your brand or another brand that you admire. Now on the bottom, which you can't see, I'm sorry, that got cut off, is UGC, so user-generated content. Once your brand or your company gets a little bit more established, sometimes you can do user-generated campaigns where your actual fans create the content for you, with you, and then that can be celebrated, which is a very effective strategy. So moving forward, I just want to talk through various different types of content that I find very inspiring, and that's also very effective to reach Gen Z audiences. And it'll be interesting to hear from those of you in Gen Z if you agree. But in my experience, creating a sense of exclusivity, like the apparel brand 400 doesn't even have a website where you can see their product. In fact, they do have a website, but you can't see it. You have to enter your mobile number. And when they have product drops, when new product releases, send you a text link, and then you can look at that mobile responsive website. So there's that sense of exclusivity that is very important. I wouldn't limit it to Gen Z, but it's youth culture and Gen Z that's driving that trend. The create digital and analog remixes. This brand Mischief, MSCHF, is one of my favorite. They also have a very interesting website that looks like an early 90s website. And they primarily are app-based. You have to also, when you use their app, similar to 400, you sign up for drops. They announce their drops. But they also just do really kind of interesting, nostalgic type surprise content. And you never really know what Mischief's going to come out with. And when you look at their responsive website and app, it looks like almost something from early 90s, but yet it's got a very savvy technical twist to it. It's definitely a site that you want to kind of look at. And you know, Mischief just kind of screams Gen Z to me, Gen Z relevance to me. Create the unexpected, you know, doing interesting brand collaborations like Kentucky Fried Chicken and Crocs, you know, one could say it's kind of gross, but anyways, it's super funny and it's just really relevant to the interesting sort of culture that Crocs has created. And so creating that unexpected is something you can do to create interest, capture attention, and drive sales. You know, create entertaining shopping experiences. This is from the App Network, which operates very similar to a very popular old traditional shopping network called QVC. It's basically branded, entertaining content that's all around new product releases that gives you the backstory, gives you the chance to purchase the product, and engage with the community, watch live episodes when the product's released, learn like how it's designed and what it's all about, what's the inspiration behind it, and then lots of drawings to gamify and create cool, fun promotions. So check out Network. It's NTWRK, and you can Google them. They're now owned by Foot Locker, so this model was very effective that Foot Locker had decided to buy it. Ways to change the world, you know, Gen Z being more socially conscious with that trend and purpose-driven brand. So this is a brand called Impactor. And what they're really doing is gamifying competition to do kind, generous, conscious actions to save the world. I-M-P-A-C-T-R. I have you look at that. It's actually impactr.app. So it's Impactor app to find them. And you see, like, they basically epitomize the Gen Z social impact trend, and it's going to be a great brand to watch. Create mind-blowing edutainment content. This is a science STEM TikTok that we recently created. I'm hoping that I can just push play here and watch it. But it's the idea of taking science and boring STEM and STEAM content and then creating something edutaining like this, and I hope you'll find it edutaining to reach Gen Z.
RJ! What would happen if I just jumped off the spaceship, just, you know?
Jumped off in space? I looked around the studio for something that I could represent you with, and here's what I think.
I think that represents my best friend a little bit better.
Does that look more like RJ?
Yeah.
Hey, RJ! To make this visible, I'm going to take some shaving cream and fill RJ's head with it. This is going to represent his brain.
Pretty accurate.
And we'll put RJ right inside the chamber. What happens when there's no more air pressure pushing on your body? 3, 2, 1.
RJ!
Go, RJ! Oh, God, yeah.
It's my best friend. I'll find a way to save him.
It would be a mess out there. That's why we have to wear a spacesuit and go out. Stay inside the ship.
Yeah,
that's going to give everybody saw that nightmares. I hope you enjoyed that. A little bit of science, a little bit of gruesome nonsense.
Yeah, I'm not letting RJ go to space now.
You get the idea. This has really been a great project to be a part of from the beginning. So now that you've been through, you know, four of these very foundational strategies to get you on your way to be in a better place to connect with Gen Z or you, if you're for the Gen Z entrepreneurs and students and so forth on here. Let's put your brand, your company, your idea to the Gen Z relevance test. This is always fun to do. So this is the Gen Z brand relevance audit. Grab a tablet, a digital notepad, or a piece of paper, and you evaluate your brand for Gen Z youth culture relevance by, you know, selecting one of these options. There's no for 0 points. There's 1 point for yeah, you're doing a good job. And 2 points for heck yeah, you're doing a really good job. And if you score more than 10 points, it's like 9 points, that means you're in that confident and you're on the right track. If you're, you know, at 18, 19, you're doing a great job, man. You must be doing everything that we've talked about here tonight and some. So let's go through the process and score yourself. So does your targeted Gen Z audience like already respect your brand? That's something you want to think about. Have you already positioned it well? Do they love you? Are they into you? And are they into what your brand, your company is doing? Will your targeted audience of Gen Z, youth culture, be able to understand the topic and get into it? I mean, is it really clear? Is it weird? Is it off? Weird's good. Is it off? Is it unclear? Can they get into it? Is there a need for it? Will your content themes or titles in your messaging? Will the engagement that you're offering captivate young people's attention? Is it going to break through the noise? It's a hard question to answer, isn't it? Can the story or your content or your product, can it be customized, personalized in some kind of way? Or flip the question differently. Is there something that's exclusive about it? Something that's just, you need to have that product? What makes that product special? Is it special? You know, can your creative team, can your product development team, can your business group, is it able to make the subject matter look and feel legitimate? Is it able to deliver, to meet the needs? Is it authentic? Is it legit? You can spin this question many different ways and question yourself. Do you think a young person in the Gen Z target audience would be perceived as cool or thanked for sharing your content because it was informative or helpful or just really rad? Another great question. Does any aspect of your brand, story, you know, bring back a fond memory of nostalgia or spark nostalgia from an era that's not even you find interesting, that's been hyped in the trends? This is a big one. After experiencing your product, your content, some aspect of your social engagement, are young people going to be inspired or empowered further to do something better, gain some kind of a goal? And this is the great stuff right here. Are you able to do something that great as a result? It's a head scratcher, isn't it? Will the story have an ending? Will you experience your content, product, your convenience, whatever it is that you offer, have people saying, oh, that's what I need. I need more of it. Because bottom line, that's going to be how you grow your brand, your audience, and your business. So I'll leave you with three key takeaways. One is listen and involve your Gen Z audience in the process. Co-create with them and commit to brand relevance with Gen Z. Thank you.
It was a great session, Gregg. Guys, if you loved what Gregg shared, please write hell yeah in the chat box, so that we can move ahead. Learned a lot of things, Gregg, a new perspective to whatever we are doing. I also run a brand called Hungrito, which targets Gen Z in a way. And I was just typing my team, if you're not in the session, everyone has to do the exercise which Gregg has given at the end. And we are having a lot of hell yeahs here. And
that's cool, man. Yeah, hell yeah.
Loved it. So, and the main part is the examples. And just to say people what I liked, the edutainment, I don't know how we spell that thing now, but education and entertainment part, which is very necessary for people to now target the youth, was one of the great things. The TikTok that you showed was awesome. A lot of good learnings for at least me and the audience is saying that they have got a lot of new things. So guys, there are 5 books which Gregg is going to give to the people who ask right questions, good questions to Gregg, and he's going to give 5 signed copies. He's going to ship them to India. He's going to ship it to us, and then we are going to deliver it to you. So do ask right questions. If somebody from US or UK or anywhere wins this, if somebody is from US, Gregg will be happy to ship them directly. If somebody is from India, we will be happy to ship them. So please ask questions and do that. Okay, so there were a few questions, Gregg, which were asked while the session was going on. I will be starting with those questions and then we can move ahead.
Okay, let's go.
Okay, so we have a lot of questions, but okay. So the first one is from Aksan. Gregg, how do you think Clubhouse will increase interaction and understanding of Gen Z?
Can you repeat that again?
Gregg, how do you think Clubhouse will increase interaction and understanding of Gen Z? So do you think on Clubhouse still Gen Z is there or they aren't there?
No, Gen Z is there. Most of the, a lot of the young professionals, huge number of Gen Z entrepreneurs are there. I mentor over 25 Gen Z sort of rising sort of entrepreneurs or creatives. They're all there. I'm there, but I've been waiting for a minute. I'm just preparing lots of new material. But I think like it's not just Clubhouse.
Yeah,
it's all of the different competitors to Clubhouse. It's that voice, that interactive, real, authentic conversation. Is a trend that's going to keep growing. I will definitely say, I think Gen Z, from my experience, Gen Z's been a key driver in Clubhouse's growth. It's certainly not just a Gen Z thing by any means, but it's I would say the driver of adoption.
True.
Or key adopters to it anyways. Did that answer the question okay?
I think yes. Then we have a question from Rashi. She is asking, what is the ideal competition for Gen Z? So if somebody is trying to target them, what can be the ideal competition for them?
What could you, I missed the word that you said, the ideal what?
Competition.
The competition?
Yeah.
Gen Z themselves is the greatest competition because it's the largest group of humans to ever be on the planet.
True.
I greatest competition for Gen Z. I think the competition is with yourself. It's to position yourself in a way to be relevant in this, you know, overpopulated group of people, and then just stand out and share your value. That's my immediate reaction because I don't know who else would be competing with Gen Z. I mean, you know,
they are so large in numbers.
Yeah.
Okay. We have a question from Sagar. Sagar is asking, what are the best channels on internet to target Gen Z for the business? Because they are everywhere in a way. And if we can take a few specific examples through which we can target them.
Yeah, it really depends on what you're doing. Like, for instance, if you're focused on e-com, which I'm really glad you asked this question because I didn't want all my examples to be awareness oriented. So if you're focused on e-commerce, then, you know, like Google's really important, going to be really, really important for you to convert. And then your audience building, Instagram still very strong to bring you closer down the funnel to a conversion. But TikTok and Snapchat, well, TikTok in particular is getting better at assisting with the funnel. And clearly there are brands on TikTok that are doing a great job converting. Snapchat is sort of, a lot of people look at Snapchat going, well, I don't know if that converts, but I think it's when they're looking at Snapchat, they're not looking at where Snapchat is being used in the funnel because it's really great for awareness. And you don't really have to look at it from that. I mean, YouTube's great. Pre-roll ads offer a ton of value. But I think just, I don't know everyone's objectives, but if you're trying to convert like sales, you definitely want to look at Google Shopping Ads, Google AdWords, and then real content driven SEO on your website.
Great.
Great. That's a hard question. Sorry.
Yes, yes, yes. So Zeeshan is asking, is Instagram a good place to attract and engage Gen Z right now?
It is. It is. It remains so. The game's getting harder.
Yeah.
It's getting a lot harder to get any organic content. Reels is offering, you know, a little bit. Instagram is really great for doing paid partnerships with influencer content creators. True. It works really well, but then you're going to need your content, your product catalog, and your internet e-com, your search e-com helping you do some more of the heavy lifting. Again, different audiences, different types of products are different, right?
Great. So then Anuj is asking, isn't it more difficult to get and hold Gen Z's attention? Because the attention span, as we are reading around the a lot of case studies and those, it is decreasing day by day. What do you think about those?
Can we swear?
Yes, we can.
That's bullshit. The attention span, people use this analogy of that Gen Z has the attention span of a goldfish.
Yeah.
But apparently they haven't watched anybody play Call of Duty or Fortnite.
Very true.
Look, you need to capture people's attention in two, three seconds or less for sure. But it doesn't mean that long form content. But then again, you see the young professionals on Clubhouse spending an hour and a half, 3 hours in a conversation, right? So it just depends on the content and it depends on the appetite. Short form content is the best for entertainment. But there are certainly longer form content that people still engage in. And I think it's just really like, how good are you at creating enough of a content mix to capture their attention?
Very
arguably, you do have to be effective and you do have to be fast.
Yeah.
But I'm not buying into the attention span stuff.
So there was something which I read online where people were saying, so the same conversation was going on. And then somebody commented, it is not about the attention span. It is just that people now love to see content which is engaging for them. So they can binge watch the whole series. And if you are saying that they cannot see something which is 8 hours long, it is bullshit in that way. Because they want good content. It is because there is so much content out there. They carve for good content, a good piece of information which you are sharing with them. So they can read books which are 1,000 pages. Game of Thrones and those kind of series have a cult following. It is not just that they don't have attention span. It is they carve for good things.
I do believe about Gen Z or all of you, whoever, is that like, I do believe that when you're growing up a digital native, you definitely are able to cut through the BS, cut through the noise quicker. So I believe that there's a more sensitive filter to, you know, to knowing if the content's good or not.
Yeah.
I don't think it's limited to Gen Z, but I think it's limited to people that are spending time on these social platforms and understand the culture and understand like how they operate, because you have to be able to filter really quick or you're not going to get to the good content. So there's truth to that. Yeah.
True. So how important is it for a brand to always be on their feet, to be continuously connected with the Gen Z as their market is very dynamic?
Like to be always connected by a...
Yeah. So what can be other ways because every time things are changing. So one platform is coming up, another platform is going down, and those kind of things every day happen. And so how should there be a connection which as a brand we can make other than social media is, I think, the question.
Oh, yeah. Other than social media, right now we're locked down. So you can put up a billboard and you can create zines and magazines. I'm joking, but I'm actually serious. You know, you can do a mix of, as more and more of the social and digital platforms, and I'm going to start with this, like you can do very strategic special editions and mixes of actual printed material will actually work, but and get attention. But what's going to happen is, so one, there's the I want to answer without it being social, because what's going to happen is the way that experiential events and then like hybrid events go over in these next few months and then over the next years, I mean, that's always important and that's going to continually be a mix. So your ability to do real world guerrilla marketing, being able to go out into the market and sample and do tours, you know, it's going to be really, really right out the gate. And then if you, it's a timeless strategy to balance that out, because you're only going to reach so many people only via social and digital. But I'll say one thing that it might be a little bit off topic, but I think it's related is that you pick a few social platforms that you can, I guess, feed. We call it feed the beast, but you can afford to keep quality content going and conversations going, and then pick whatever the numbers you can handle, but pick a few that are emerging and experiment with them so that you're getting used to them and you understand how they work, like Dispo. I mean, you know, there's literally hundreds now.
Yeah.
So that you can try out. And so that's something that I do with my team all the time, is we just try to make sure that we understand them properly. So that's like, for me personally, even with Clubhouse, I've just been kind of a user, you know, just there going to sessions, just like kind of honing in some of my material, but making sure that I'm aware of how the interface works and how just setting up rooms works. And it's important to go do that in many of these other social platforms, House Party, and even Pinterest. These platforms all have value, right? Yeah. So go ahead.
Okay. So then we have a very interesting question from Ravina. Should brands have a totally different strategy for Gen Z? Because they are targeting a lot of, so suppose there is a brand like Nike, Adidas. So they're big brands and they want to target the new age people who are coming up. So should they have a different strategy for Gen Z? Should they have a different strategy for millennials? Should that be the case?
Yeah, I mean, it depends on your brand and sort of how like youthful it is and sort of how, like we saw Thorn, like, You have to have a different strategy for a brand that's so far disconnected from the audience. But then if you're so big and you're already very, very relevant, well, Nike had to have very, very hyper segment specific strategies just because people need to believe it.
True.
Now, so has Levi's.
Yeah.
So has Adidas. So has New Balance, right? So it's important for you to, for the brand, large or small, to really understand those cultural groups that are influencing, you know, immersion or interest or and sales in those products. So the answer is like sometimes you do, and then like sometimes you don't. Like for instance, you can't just like talk, if your brand typically is targeting older parents who are very conservative, then you start asking yourself the question, a sub-brand, because you can't have those conversations in the same channel. It's just too weird. And you're going to basically have every audience. Yeah. Like, oh, sorry. I started looking. There's some really great questions in the chat. 100 Thieves. That was a great question. But anyways, so not all the time, but you definitely want to be aware of each segment and how you're treating them so that you can determine if you need to create a totally different strategy for Gen Z.
Okay. So
it's kind of a bad answer, but sorry.
So Ray has a question. How can we incorporate this into three ways of growing businesses? Increase number of clients, increase average transaction value, and increase frequency of repurchase.
Well, how you operate this, you, once again, you bring the target audience along with you and listen, get feedback, and get ideas of what's going to work for them. You know, a mix of influencers and a mix of, you know, people that they influence and even different stakeholders in the game to make sure. And then you get that content right. You figure out the right channels to be on. How do you incorporate? I mean, I love the question because what we're talking about is acquisition. You know, yes. We're talking about conversion here. Like, the key is you build an audience, which isn't easy to do. You know, and you don't have to build an audience, but then whether you build an audience or like you don't build an audience, you need to get that content, that message, and that product and that price right, and you got to go out and test the shit out of it. You know, I mean, that's the answer that no one wants to hear to this question, you know, because I'm running digital media buys all the time, you know, that convert. And I see the ones that convert and I see the ones that don't convert. And, you know, it can be very different. You need to test dynamic content with static content, just text only content, you know, all kinds of testing. I hope that answers the question because that's the $1 billion question that you've asked. So I really appreciate that question. That, by the way, that you get a book.
You great. Definitely get a book. Ray is the first person who is going to get the book. There's a question by Prerna. What are your views on Gen Z and millennials trying to quit social media over time? Any specific approach brands can take to play a role in making this social space more meaningful? Because a lot of people always say we are doing a detox and we are out of social media for time because there is so much things that they do on social media. So what is your view on that?
Yeah, I think detoxing is a trend. I mean, look, I think that there's going to be like counseling and like therapy, like literally, like I'm not joking, like literal like therapy and stuff for like social content, like overload and anxiety. Obviously, that's already obviously
happening.
You know, so I think that, you know, it's, you know, let me look at the question. Like, so yes, yeah, some people are going to quit social media. People quit social media and they come back. They have to determine where social media fits in their life. They have to determine if they're able to put parameters around it.
Yes.
You know, that enables, you know, them to do that. I think in some ways, brand like, look, Mischief is an interesting brand. Like, Dump 400, they might actually have a super active Instagram, but there's a lot of brands that are doing sort of walled gardens that are kind of not going for the whole social thing. They're doing, you know, earned media on grandioso scales with just massive influencer campaigns and then just making everything be sort of an SMS. Or some other kind of virtual experience where it's very exclusive, and they brands are doing that, and the older school brands, the big mainstream brands, they don't even get that. Like, that's where like Gen Z is very game changing, and like because the big brands don't even get that at all. They're not even on that. They're not even onto that yet. So any specific approach brands can take to play a role in making the social space more meaningful. I mean, any of the brands that are truly doing something for social change, you know, where it's actually going out into the real world, like Impactor, that brand I showed you, Impactor,
yeah,
they're doing something to make the social space more meaningful. Yeah, I mean, I hope that answers your question.
Great. So we have another question, which I usually ask, but somebody from audience has asked. they get access to your latest research on Gen Z. How can they do that? Buy the book?
Just call my hotline. In the DMs, email me, Gregg, G-R-E-G-G, at engageyouth.com. And that's the best way. LinkedIn.
Great. So we have a question from Pragnesh. Where do you start in changing the mindset in markets like India, where there's clear ignorance of Gen Z with respect to kind of products and services being built? Because most of the people who build in India are trying to get attention of people who have money. And Gen Z is right now not the audience which has money. They are still in college or they just passed out of college. And so the budget is short for them. And so Red Bull kind of brands are still targeting them, but other brands are not. So how can that mindset be changed in the market?
More events like this.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
I mean, really, thing. And in taking the traffic data, like how much of Gen Z, anyone, I will offer this to anyone. I have a lot of data on like how much, I was actually going to use it in this presentation, of how like the size, the percentage of Gen Z in each country. Because if you look at India, it's massive. And if you look at, there's a lot of other interesting, you know, countries where it's massive. It's much larger than the UK and the US, by the way.
True.
Taking this data and then looking at just the economic impact that that has. Well, here in the US and in the European and in the EU and UK, we've been using that kind of almost generic, here's the size of the market. We've been using that for almost 10 years. You know, previously we did that with millennial, because I'm always focused on like life state and then cultural. So you just have to continually educate in like every presentation, every new VC or investor you're talking to, or you know, it's always in the front part, even if it just seems repetitive. You as individuals are responsible to educate them, and then it's the organizations and companies like yourself doing this and making sure this content gets to them.
Great answer to that question, Gregg. And plus one for India is going to have the highest number of Gen Z crowd, which is going to be there in the world. So
yeah.
So there's a question by Gauri. Is there any way through which we can teach, instruct, command Gen Z about global issues, which keeping our marketing goals in place as well? So there are a lot of issues oriented marketing, which has been there in the market right now. So what is your take on that?
Command. I'm reading this here. Okay. Teach or instruct or direct Gen Z as a demographic about global issues while keeping their marketing goals in place. Yeah, absolutely. It needs to align with your brand mission, though. Like, it needs to align in a way that doesn't look fishy. It's got to look like it's an authentic connection between like those issues with your brand, the way that your brand operates. You have to market that. Like, you know, you have to do the groundwork. I mean, that's a great example of a reason why to have an advisory council on board, just with that as one of your primary goals or initiatives, right? So there's a lot of ways to do that. So you incorporate, you know, find out more about what's gonna motivate that particular group that's a part of your company, of your group. Educate your internal teams about what that is, because if you can't get adoption of that, those social issues internally with your own employees and people, you're not gonna be able to do it. So the audience, through the advisory type groups, the internal work of getting them really on, and then explications like over and over and over and over again, whether it's, you know, racial injustice or, you know, ethical, you know, labor, you know, climate, you know, whatever it is. These are the things that you have to do, and you got to make it front and center, and you just don't quit until you've made impact, you know, but making it transparent so that everyone involved sees what kind of impact is being made, and equally as transparent to understand when it's not being made, to understand what they can do to improve upon it. You know, it's like, I don't have the answer to your question, but it may be part of the process and the steps that you can take.
Great. So we have another question. Let us quickly take a question because we are already over time, but the way conversation is going, can we continue, Gregg, with a few more questions?
Yeah, I'm good. I don't want to take from other speakers, but yeah.
Yeah. So Gen Z are extremely diverse and have extremely polarizing opinions on everything. So either they are extreme right, extreme left in that way. It is not about political, but the topics that we talk about. So how can a startup target the wide Gen Z market by its product without opposing views? Or is there a way that they can go moderate on topics, and a few topics they don't touch and a few topics they touch? How should they do? Because there are opinions on every piece of content which is there online. So something happens politically, everybody has an opinion. Something happens culturally, everybody has an opinion. A politician or a film actor or a star does something, everybody has an opinion. Should a brand stand by those things or not?
Absolutely, man. figure out what you stand for. That's what I mean. Like, you know, I actually had one of my slides got deleted at the end, but it just was like, listen, co-create, which is involve, and then commit. And commitment is the make or the break, right? Because that's the long-term thing. Look, you can't be all things to all people. It's not possible. You have to cement this targeting at very, very clear brand values, very, very clear objectives and strategies. And I'm telling you, the big desire is always, I want to get the masses. But I'm telling you, you find those core audiences, build strong, strong relationships with them, and then the niche cultures, the niche audiences drive mass consumption. And I'm telling you, it's a formula that is so much easier said than done. And you can look to companies like Vans and other companies that have done this very, very well. They reach mass audiences. You know, you look at like T-Mobile, you go look at like Skull Candy, Beats by Dre, you look at all these brands, they're reaching mass audiences. And they've spent their time investing in smaller niche cultural groups that in that slide I showed you in the beginning form supergroups, which are then through that Venn diagram able to connect to massive audiences. So the biggest Fortune 100 companies, maybe they don't have the money to reach every big massive spread. And if you do, I would advise not to. So you can appeal to, you can't appeal to everyone. And, you know, I think it's okay to have haters. You know, like, because you're going to be in a worse position to keep changing what you're backing over time, you know. And here's the deal. You don't have to, if there's something really controversial, but you think, you know, and you don't have to do it. You know, you can take a stand if you're that confident, or you don't have to engage in it or do it or be a part of it if it's super controversial and you're worried about it. That's the other side, right?
Yes.
You know, it's a hard question to answer, and no, you don't want to fall prey to cancel culture. But you know, I hope that I added some texture to it.
Great. So there is another question which is on the same lines. What would be key to keep up with the trends because the attention span is low and the trends change so fast? There are a lot of questions on attention span, but I think, Gregg, you have already answered the questions on attention span.
But there's still like a substantial part of this question that deserves an answer. Yeah. You can't just say like a short attention span. That's not going to be a very good answer. Yeah. You know, the key is to understand the sources, know the social platforms, know where you as a brand owner, as a company representative, as a agency, whatever, that you can do your own research. And then it's really important to review and scan and know what the one-off trend reports are saying. And then it's really important to be tracking like a 4 or 5 time a year, like our trend report does. And I'm not just trying to sell us. I'm just saying there's other people that do it too, and be able to see what's going on no less than a quarterly. But what we find, and other global partners of ours find very valuable, as do startups, that bringing this sort of advisory type group on board with at minimum 1 or 2 interactions a month, where you can have a survey, but you can also have some either video based or Zoom based or some other app based like video dialogue. That's going to be with a smaller group of people. That's going to be how you stay onto the trends, and really and really keep yourself immersed.
Great, great. So can we take a few more? Or
I'm good, man. I'm good. It's only 10 p.m.
Yeah. But thanks a lot, Gregg, for doing this. And the audience is loving it. There are questions which are flowing. And I love the background. A lot of skateboards. And that, guys, shows the passion in a way that what you are passionate about. In that way.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
Love the background. So there's a question by Rohit. Brands like Apple, Microsoft, Tata, Reliance change their strategies over time according to people they target. Because these are big brands. When they started in 1980s, 1970s, or Tata is a 100-year-old, 120, 130-year-old brand. They changed the course over of their marketing over time. So for targeting Gen Z, what are the things that you think they will be changing in the coming years?
Yeah, I actually think that the core brand strategies and a lot of the business strategies of these companies have actually been pretty anchored into a core. So I'm not really sure that I agree that their strategies have changed too much over time. Of course they've evolved over time, and certainly that they're creative. And their messaging is modified over the years, like quite a bit. They are very targeted at mass audiences, but they're so deeply immersed in their core users. They never disconnect. They are always on. I mean, far beyond the advisory councils. I mean, they're just immersed in their core users. So how much do you think one should compromise on their sole purpose? I mean, I don't think you should ever compromise for an age demographic or a generational cohort. I think, like, how do you prove yourself? And I'll tell you, the ultimate way to do this is you find your fandom. You know, you find your cultural fandoms, and then they span ages, right? Like fandoms aren't always, and they're often not limited to an age demographic. So it's again, you know, back to that whole brand positioning piece. Yeah. Like, it depends. Like, you know, if you're creating a new Microsoft product that probably better positioned for gamers or musicians, then you are going to have that conversation internally to determine whether this should be I hasten to say Gen Z, but yeah, to be a more youth focused product that might not fit under the, you know, I'll say it, like the sort of stiff looking Microsoft brand, but like, I'm friends with many people at Microsoft. I'm just being honest. Like, you know what I mean? It's like, they have a value proposition that's incredibly strong. And so they're, you know, Apple has a value proposition unlike any other, you know? And so, but it just depends on what they're doing. You know, Apple has been one of those unique brands that's driven trends. So you almost have Gen Z, like, you know, I'm not excluding Samsung or other, you know, technologies, but almost like some of those technologies are driving, you know, Gen Z's on their spaceship.
Yeah.
You know, which is not, doesn't happen as much as that used to happen in the 90s, right? Because now, you know, consumers are driving a lot of the trends. So I say, keep your values intact, know your positioning, have some flexibility, but don't waver in the wind. There.
Great, great, great. I think we are already over time a lot. And so for anybody else who have their questions, you can reach out to Gregg on LinkedIn and the email address that he has given. Plus one for giving out the books by Gregg. We will be soon sharing the list on our Instagram handle. While having a discussion with Gregg, which were the 5 questions that he liked the most. Other thing, inspired by Gregg, we will be also giving those 5 people Linkjar subscription for 1 year. just upping the game in the end for the people who ask the questions. Thanks a lot, Gregg, again. This has been the best, I think, the session in a way where people have engaged that much, and one of the most valuable session, because the topic that we had was targeting the people who are going to be the people who are going to buy a lot of things in the coming 5 years. And these are the people who are going to be in the limelight. These are the internet first generation that we are talking about. Thanks a lot. Enjoyed a lot. Learned a lot of things. Thank you for coming.
Oh, thank you so much for having me, everyone. Have a great day. I'm going to go to sleep.
Great. Thanks a lot. Do like the channel. Do subscribe. There are a lot of things which are coming tonight also, guys. And thanks a lot, Gregg, for coming in. Thanks a lot, everybody, for joining us. Do like the video if you have liked it. Thank you.